This section should give a short introduction to burns, chemical injuries, and electrical injuries. Injuries to the skin or mucous membrane caused by exposure to heat are called burn injuries. The seriousness of these burns may vary from unpleasant scorching to life-threatening injuries. These are partial or full-thickness burns. The seriousness of these burn injuries depends on three factors. Localization. Where is the burn injury? Burns to the face, hands, feet and pelvis are of particular concern. Percentage of total body surface burnt is important. Here we use the rule of nines, where the body is divided into equal areas, equaling multiples of 9% of the total body surface area. This is a fast way to estimate the percentage of total body surface affected. Depth. How deep does the injury extend to the skin? The extent of danger depends on the depth. It may be difficult to establish the depth of the injury immediately, and you must therefore consider the cause of injury. Is there blood circulation in the skin? Is there absence of sensibility? By observation, you may find that the extent of burns not necessarily belong to any one group alone, but be spread among the first, second, or the third degree. The symptoms of burns are divided into the following three categories. First degree burn, which causes red skin, and dry, painful skin. Second degree burn, which causes red skin and blemishes. Second degree burns are extremely painful and blistering. Third degree burn, which causes scalded skin or pale skin, open infected wounds and or respiratory failure. If the patient has been exposed to open flame, smoke or damp, the first aider must be aware of the state of the patient's breathing. Even though the skin burns may not be life-threatening, heat injuries to the lungs and throat can partially or totally obstruct the airways. The symptoms of heat inhalation are heavy breathing and or rapid breathing, coughing, unconsciousness, soot around the mouth. First aid treatment is the same for all burn injuries. Cool the patient, trying to minimize the damage and ease the pain. However, be aware that the core body temperature is kept normal at 37 degrees Celsius to prevent hypothermia. Get the patient away from the hot area. Extinguish flames and burning clothes. Then start the treatment of the patient. Remember the ABC handling procedure. Major burns are always a threat to normal respiratory function and circulation because of the loss of body fluids through the wounds and formation of peripheral swellings. Therefore, be aware of this during treatment. To be on the safe side, the patient may be placed in supine position, If the patient is injured by smoke inhalation or smoke poison, it is extremely important to give large quantities of oxygen. The following steps should be taken to treat a burn injury. Cool with ice water for 1 to 3 minutes. Then cool with water, 15 to 20 degrees Celsius, for 20 to 30 minutes. It is very important to keep the injured area under water. When the injured area is cooled sufficiently, cover with sterile dry bandages. Second and third degree burns must immediately, or as soon as possible, be treated at a hospital. Do not submerge the whole body in ice water. Do not puncture blemishes or try to remove burned clothing. This will increase the damage and the danger of infection. Certain chemicals may irritate, harm, or be absorbed through the skin, causing widespread and sometimes fatal damage. Unlike thermal burns, the signs develop slowly, but the first aid is the same. Most strong corrosives are found in industry, although chemical burns do occur in the home, especially from dishwater products, the most frequent cause of alkali burns in children, oven cleaners, and paint stripper. Chemical burns are always serious and may require urgent hospital treatment. If possible, note the name or brand name of the substance. Ensure your own safety. Some chemicals give off deadly fumes. Chemical burns may be recognized by evidence of chemicals in the vicinity, intense stinging pain. Later, discoloration, blistering, peeling, and swelling of the affected area. In order to treat chemical burns, your aims are to disperse the harmful chemical, to arrange transport to the hospital, and to make the area safe and inform the relevant authority. First, make sure that the area is safe. Ventilate the area and, if possible, seal the chemical container from the area if necessary. Flood the affected area with water to disperse the chemical and to stop the burning. Do this for longer than for a thermal burn, at least 20 minutes. Gently remove any contaminated clothing while flooding the injury. Take or send the casualty to hospital. Watch the airways and breathing closely. Note and pass on any details about the chemical to medical personnel. Burns may occur when electricity passes through the body. Much of the visible damage occurs at the points of entry and exit of the current. However, there may also be a track of internal damage. The position and direction of entry and exit wounds will alert you to the likely extent of hidden injury and to the degree of shock that may ensue. Burns caused by electricity may be recognized as unconsciousness. Full thickness burns with swelling, scorching and charring at both the point of entry and exit. Signs of shock. A brown coppery residue on the skin if the casualty has been a victim of arcing high voltage electricity. In order to treat burns caused by electricity, your aims are to treat the burns and shock and to arrange removal of the casualty to the hospital. Make sure that contact with the electric source is broken. If the casualty is unconscious, open the airway and check breathing. Be prepared to resuscitate if necessary. Flood the sites of injury with plenty of cold water to cool the burns and cut away any burned clothing if necessary. Place a sterile dressing, a clean folded triangular bandage, or some other clean, non-fluffy material over the burns to protect them from airborne infection. Reassure the casualty and treat for shock.